Applied geomorphology is a very important topic of geomorphology. It is last but not least. As all the natural sciences have application, the aim of which is human welfare and welfare of environment. For example, physics, chemistry, geology, botany, biology, geomorphology, climatology, mineralogy, seismology, volcanology, speleology. A number of sciences are there which aim at the welfare of human society. And man, after having a complete knowledge of these sciences, thinks to use their knowledge for the welfare of human society. Now let us come to understand what is geomorphology. Geomorphology is the scientific study of landforms, different types of landforms, by endogenic and exogenic forces. This we have studied in detail, that there are endogenic forces which give birth to landform and different slopes, while exogenic forces like fluvial process, karst, marine, wind, glacial, periglacial give design these landforms and bring about change in the shape and size of landform. Now let us try to understand what is applied. Applied means its application, the application of knowledge of geomorphic landforms and processes. So applied geomorphology is the use of landforms and geomorphic processes by man for the welfare of society and environment, especially these days when it is age of environmental conservation. Now, applied geomorphology has three aspects. Number one, we will study different aspects of applied geomorphology with reference to all the six denudational processes. Then, second aspect of applied geomorphology will be the use of plateau, plain, and mountain, and human interference with geomorphic features there. Third aspect will be today in the field of development, there are a number of sciences working and planning. So how geomorphology is interconnected with those, and how those sciences like engineering, hydrology are using the geomorphic knowledge for the development of society, development of landscape, that will be third aspect. Now let us come to first aspect, means aspect of applied geomorphology with respect to process. There are six denudational processes: fluvial, aeolian, karst, marine, glacial, and periglacial. In fluvial process, we have studied in detail from the source of a river to its mouth, all the landforms, erosional and depositional, developed therein, and how man is interacting with the fluvial process and landforms developed by that. But let us discuss a list of applied geomorphology. Number one is bunding. Let us start from the river source. There are a number of rills and gullies which make headward erosion each year during rainy season and convert that land into ravine. So to control the process of ravination, rill, especially rill head, is being controlled by the process of extra bunding. Now second is I-shaped valley. I-shaped valley is formed by antecedent rivers on the folded mountains which rise on the path of those antecedent rivers like Colorado, Indus, Satluj, and Brahmaputra. So this I-shaped valley is a center of tourism, that is applied geomorphology. Next is dam and reservoir. While coming down but along the steep slope, dams are being constructed on the rivers, and with the result, reservoirs come into existence. This is also application of geomorphic conditions by engineers. Next is waterfall. Waterfall is a landform that attracts tourists, and the government concerned collects money as a tax for tourism. Next is worship stones from Bhabhar. In Bhabhar region, there are a number of boulders of different size which are being collected by the worshippers, and that is being used for worship stone. Next is Tarai rice. In Tarai region, just downstream the Bhabhar, there is deposition of clay which is suitable for rice and sugar cane cultivation. And downward, you will see that dike and spurs are being constructed just to control the lateral erosion by the meander, and their bluffs move. And when dike and spur is being constructed, those bluffs stop moving. Thus, cultural landscape along the bank of rivers are being protected. Next is barrage. Downstream, to control the flood and river water diversion for canal irrigation, barrage are being constructed. For example, Harike barrage and Farakka barrage in India. Next is Anikat. Downstream, some small barrages are being constructed, and from here diversion canals are dug and irrigation is being practiced, and flood downstream is also controlled. Next is weir. Weir is also type of anikat or barrage, but of very mini scale, and it is made up of mud just to control the water and practice fishing. And next is hydel energy. As we have discussed that when dam and reservoirs are being constructed, hydel energy is being produced, and the energy or hydel energy is managed within the basin area and outside it. Now, after understanding the applied geomorphology in fluvial region, let us come to arid and semi-arid region where aeolian process is at work. In arid and semi-arid region, the wind speed is very fast, and that wind shifts sand dunes and sea of sand. So it is very harmful and disaster. Just to control it, wind breaks are being by preparing a belt of trees. Next is oasis. You are aware of the fact that in desert area, if there is some depression or low-lying small area, the small water of rainfall is being collected in it, and in the vicinity of that water body, grasses, shrubs, trees grow, and for that, a number of animals come to that place and inhabit there. That's why people also reach there, because they get water, vegetation and animals. That's why this is oasis, and sometimes artificial oasis are also being created by the arid geomorphologist. Next is karma. You are aware of the fact that in desert area there are some naked rocks and stones. That's why people use this path for travel in desert regions. And next is sand dune. There are some sand dune is a desert topography which attracts tourists, and sand dunes are found in the heart of different deserts, hot deserts of world, like Kalahari, Sahara, Australian desert, and in Thar Desert, Rajasthan. Jaisalmer has very peculiar sand dune, National Sand Dune Park. Next point is sand dune stabilizations. Sand dunes are drifted or shifted by speedy winds. That's why the sand dune stabilization can be done with the suggestion of arid and semi-arid geomorphologist. For it, sprinkling irrigation, social forestry and other measures are being adopted. Next is, this sand shifting is being controlled by forestry and drip and sprinkling irrigation. Next point is canal network. In arid and semi-arid region, there is extension of canal and its distributaries. For example, in Rajasthan, Indira Canal and its sub-branches have proved helpful in stabilizing sand dune and soil there. And next is dry zone agriculture is being practiced in arid and semi-arid regions of world, and coarse grain crops are produced here for which drip and sprinkling irrigation practice is taken into practice. Next is wind energy. Wind energy is produced in the areas where wind speed is very strong, and everybody is aware of the fact that along the coast wind speed is very strong, and second point, in desert region wind speed is high. That's why there, with the help of aero generator, wind energy is being produced. But here it is question of debate whether this wind energy should be included in applied geomorphology or applied climatology. Virtually this belongs to applied climatology, but because wind is a process, and if it is controlled and this energy is used for human welfare, then due to decrease in wind speed, the shifting of sand dune and sand sea will be controlled. That's why this can be used here also, but the relevant will be that it is part of applied climatology. Next is karst topography process and applied geomorphology. You know that in karst region, the limestone structure predominates, and their mining of limestone is being practiced for cement industry. Next is cave use. Cave, the scientific study of cave is called speleology, and if we know that there is cave, then we want to see that natural scene, and tourists in large number gather there, and the concerned government collects money for seeing this natural geomorphic feature. Next is religion. In cave, there are some stalactites, which people think that it is nature's creation, and people, especially religious people, reach there for worship. Next is terra rosa or terra roxa soil. When the entire karst topography collapses and at last polygy landscape is developed, means the entire erosional and depositional landscapes are washed away, then the remaining coarse material on the ground is called terra rosa or terra roxa soil, which is suitable for the production of coffee crop. Now come to marine process and its application for human welfare. One landscape is natural bridge, which is used by the tourist to reach just on the shore of the sea and thus government collects money from the tourist. And when the natural bridge collapses, the stake is left there. Stake is a major or minor part of raised land of hard rock, which is above the datum plane or sea level, and the tourist reach by boat to that stack and enjoy the natural beauty of the oceans. Next is escarpment. It is the large scale scarp and people stand there and see the nature's beauty. Next is beach tourist. Beach is very important feature along the coastline, and the tourist, especially the foreigners of high latitude, reach Indian beach just to enjoy. Thus, this is a geomorphic feature and its application is practiced at a large scale. Next, beaches are of two types. Number one is sandy beach and number two is rocky beach. And you are aware of the fact whether on the west coast of India it will be sandy beach or rocky beach. Certainly rocky beach. Why? Because the western part of India has been raised by the tectonic activities and the western coast has been eroded by the marine waves from the Arabian Sea. That's why this beach is rocky. Contrary to it, the east coast beach of India is sandy and clay. Why? Because a number of rivers like Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna, Kaveri, draining from northwest to southeast, drain into Bay of Bengal and they deposit vast and extensive deltas where beaches of sandy nature are clay nature. So on sandy beach, agriculture of rice, coconut and others is being practiced. Then marine energy. As you know that from the marine waves, a number of energy is being produced. For example, tidal energy, wave energy and osprey energy. And these energy are also considered in applied geomorphology. But here again, there is a matter of dispute whether it should be put in applied geomorphology or applied oceanography. So better it should be considered in applied oceanography. But because marine process sculptures the coastal landform, that's why if its energy is being taken by man, then its speed will be controlled. With the result, the erosion process will decrease and the landform development will also decrease. That's why it may be considered in applied geomorphology. Now, we are fed up of these processes, fluvial, arid, semi-arid, because these are having high temperature and humidity. Now let us move to cold and cool areas where glacial and periglacial process are at work and landforms being developed. People from plain and plateau are moving towards these regions, and how they are using that knowledge for human welfare, let us consider one by one. The landform developed by glacial process is coal, and this coal is used for routes from one side of mountain to the other side. For example, Indira coal. And next is Paternoster Lake. Downstream the glacial river, there is a Paternoster Lake. Like the water gathered at the foot of waterfall, here Paternoster lakes are formed at the foot or base of giant or cyclopean estuaries, and this Paternoster Lake water is being used by tourists and local people there, and sometimes it is carried downstream through the drains. Next is routes through Nubra Valley. It is an example. Sometimes the glaciers come down and the valley is U-shaped. The bottom or base of the valley is very flat and is smooth. So just to reach the glaciers, people follow this track. The example is Nubra Valley in Jammu and Kashmir. Our Indian Army follows this Nubra Valley to reach from lake to Siachen glacier just to protect the border. Thus, a number of valleys are glaciated valleys are there, the course of which is being used for the route. And next is outwash plain. When the glaciers come to an end, the sediment, especially fine sediment, eroded and transported by them are being deposited at the end, which is called outwash plain. It is a fine structure, although agriculture is not practiced there, but some forestry is being done. Why agriculture is not possible? Because of very low temperature in higher regions. And next is moraine. Moraine means the material brought down by the glaciers is deposited in low-lying areas, which help us to decide the age of this morainic deposition and different heights in different periods of glaciation. And next is tourism. Tourism is also practiced in glaciated region. For example, Gangotri, Yamunotri, these are the religious centers as well as tourist spots. These are concerned with the glacial process and landfall. And next is periglacial region. Periglacial region surrounds the glacial region. In periglacial region, water freezes and melts, and the melt water is used as a source of drinking water and for other purposes, because people reach in this region. Especially periglacial region predominates in the form of a belt in Russia or in Siberia. There people are there which use this water in different ways. Next is boulder for building material. In periglacial region, there is freeze and thaw cycle in which the stones are one, come up, then go down according to the seasonal variation in the freeze and thaw. And these stones are being used for building purposes, because you might have seen that some people get these stones fixed on their boundary walls just to make it more attractive. So these are the different processes, especially six processes, geomorphic processes and landforms and human interaction with them for the welfare of human society and environment. The second aspect of applied geomorphology is interaction of man with different topographies like mountain, plateau, and application of landform and process there. Now, let us come to folded mountain, which have high snow-clad peaks and tourist spots. So, human society has deep interaction with the mountainous topography. For example, there are ropeways constructed to reach from valley bottom to mountain peaks for tourism, and there are health resorts on mountain tops like Mussoorie, Shimla, Nainital, and all over world. Second, application of geomorphic knowledge over mountainous terrain is mining. In folded soft sedimentary structure, sometimes coal, limestone, and other minerals are found, which are mined there, keeping the slope variable and other geomorphic variables in mind. Tunnel formation is also need of the present day. For example, Jawahar Tunnel in Jammu and Kashmir, which leads route to Srinagar. Likewise, terrace farming is practiced over folded mountain structures where there is a thin or thick layer of soil, and terrace farming also requires correct knowledge of geomorphology. And next is contour plowing. Contour plowing is practiced over mountainous terrain just to protect soil from being eroded. and contour roads are also constructed to protect the landscape from landslide and protect the road and other cultural landscape. Next point, overfolded mountainage, agriculture. In agriculture, especially salt agriculture, this salt stands for slope agriculture land technology, slope agriculture land technology, which is practiced in mountainous slopy terrain. For example, this is practiced in Odisha, where rainfall is scarce and the water from mountain top is slowly released. First used in the fields of upper part of mountain, then it is slowly and gradually released for the lower fields. Next is tea. For example, tea plantation is practiced on mountain slopes in northeast India, and food production like apple and other citrus fruits is also practiced in mountainous terraces and regions. For example, Jammu and Kashmir, Himachal Pradesh and other regions of folded mountains in the world. Now, from mountain, let us come to plain and see how man is interacting with the geomorphic features. Here, mining is practiced. Although most of the minerals are found in plateau region, because all the ancient rocks of Angara and Gondwana land are found over plateau, but some mining is practiced in plain. For example, from river valleys, mining of silt for building material is practiced. In plain area, there is good network of road, rail and other means of communication. Hence, tourism also flourishes in these areas, and plains are the heartland of agricultural work, and plains are very much suitable for different types of crop production because their fertile soil is there, plain topography is there, and rich water resources, maybe surface water or groundwater, is available there. Now come to plateau region. As we have discussed that all the plateau are part of Angara land or Gondwana land, consisting of ancient Dharwadian, Kudapa and Archean rocks, and those rocks contain a number of precious metallic and non-metallic minerals. That's why most of the mining is practiced in plateau region. For that, geomorphic knowledge is compulsory, and geomorphologists apply that knowledge for the welfare of human society and environment. Agriculture is also practiced in plateau region, but the thickness of soil is less. Soil has no so much humus, and that's why the coarse grain crops are produced here. Next is tourism. As we see that in the plateau region of India, there are a number of tourist spots like Dhupgarh, Nilgiri, because in the plateau region there are ranges and peaks also which attract tourists. Next is forestation. Forestation is not practiced so much in plain area, but the plateau are having nearly naked rocks which become hot during summer season. That's why forest department plans forestation, afforestation and reforestation in plateau region. For example, take Aravali region, part of Indian plateau, Vindhyachal, Satpura. On these ranges, the government of India and especially forest department has planned for forestry, and there the topography, structure and geomorphic knowledge is being used. Then the third phase of applied geomorphology is application of geomorphic knowledge in different fields. There are a number of fields of development in India and abroad, and Fortunately, all these development programs either take place over folded mountains or plain or plateau. These are not practiced in ocean basins. That's why the knowledge of geomorphology is relevant everywhere. And second point, the applied geomorphology is useful here also. For example, case number one, geomorphology and regional planning. All the countries practice regional planning for the development of the total country and especially that macro, meso or micro region. That region may be arid or humid or mountainous. For example, take arid region in Rajasthan desert. There, DPAP, drought prone area program, is being practiced wherein geomorphic conditions and landscapes are taking under consideration. Next program is DDP, desert development program. There are two types of desert in India and all over world. For example, in India, hot desert program in Rajasthan, where drip and sprinkling irrigation and other programs are being practiced. And other desert is cold. For example, in Ladakh, cold desert development program are prepared having applied geomorphology knowledge. Next is basin management. As we have discussed in detail, basin is very important because it has water resource, and the water resource of that basin provides base for the development of biosphere, soil and agriculture, road, transport and human society there. That's why in basin management, main point is the construction of dam, reservoir, taking out canal from it for CCA or culturable catchment area. Now let us see how geomorphological knowledge helps us in disaster management. There are a number of disasters: climatic disasters, oceanic disasters and geomorphological disasters, and how this knowledge helps human society to manage that disaster. Take example like earthquake. There are some earthquake or seismic belts in world, and to protect human society from these disasters, their earthquake free construction are being prepared or planned. Likewise, there are disasters like landslide, which generally takes place over folded mountain structure along steep slope, and this landslide is also being controlled by proper planning. Having the knowledge of geomorphology in applied form. Next is tsunami. Although tsunami is a phenomena of ocean, but this tsunami attacks the coastal region. Hence, coastal physical landscape and cultural landscape undergoes disaster. That's why planning is done there also. Next is geomorphology and urbanization. As we know that urbanization is the growth and development of urban centers along coastline and along rivers and sometimes along the slope of mountain. Suppose we are developing or planning a city along coast or marine coast, then we have to keep their geomorphological facts in mind. What is the structure there? How marine waves are working there? Whether tectonic belt is there or not? These geomorphological knowledge have to be kept in mind for proper planning. Suppose one city is located along river, so that city continuously grows and expands into the river valley. And as we know that today, all the river valleys of world are undergoing sedimentation and siltation due to global warming and sea level rising. So there is a tussle, there is a dualism or struggle between urbanization and river flood. If you will block the river bed, then water will cause flood and submerge the urban areas along the river. That's why Supreme Court of India has issued an order to avoid construction of settlements 500 meters away from the mid valley, and mountain slopes are also suitable for urban settlement development because in mountainous areas there is urbanization. As today tourism is developing, that's why the structure, slope and other geomorphic factors are to be considered while planning the urban centers over mountain slopes. Next is geomorphology and engineering. Today engineering work is growing in all fields, and engineering work in mountain region, plateau and plain requires applied geomorphological knowledge. For example, road and rail construction and dam and airport construction needs the correct knowledge of structure, slope, nature of soil and strength of the earth there. On the basis of that, these cultural landscapes may be developed. Next is geomorphology and hydrology. As we know that hydrology is the scientific study of water in atmosphere, on land, underground or ocean, and especially on land, water is found as surface water, groundwater, and that water resource management requires geomorphic knowledge because in mountainous terrain the water resource is less, and in desert region also is scanty, but in plain areas water resource is rich, which should be wisely used for the betterment of human society. This is applied geomorphology and hydrology. Next is geomorphology and mineral resources. As we know that most of the metallic and non-metallic precious mineral resources are found in plateau region. So before mining that resource, geomorphic knowledge is necessary and the process or geomorphic process operating there. Likewise, drilling of petroleum also requires the knowledge of geomorphic structure. And next is geomorphology and agriculture. As we have discussed that the geomorphic features, slope, soil, hydrology, control agriculture. For example, jute agriculture or jute farming is practiced in the low-lying area where there is water logging, sufficient water that may be flood-prone area. For example, West Bengal, Bangladesh. And next point is flood in valley. Flood in fluvial valleys, for example, in India, may be Ganga, Brahmaputra, or abroad, Mississippi, Missouri, Murray, Darling, Huangho. All these valleys are frequently affected by flood. But farmers practice some agriculture and grow different jayat crops in those valley, which are frequently affected by flood hazards. That's why those farmers, those agriculturists practicing agriculture in valley should have accurate knowledge of process. Then comes agriculture and terrace farming. As we have discussed that along mountain slopes, terrace farming is practiced and there is a contour plowing. Along terraces, a number of rabi crops are grown. And salt agriculture has already been discussed, that slope agriculture, land technology, the example of which is in Odisha, where is mountain and scarce rain. But in other regions also, salt agriculture is being practiced. Next point is geomorphology and health. Geomorphology also controls health because suppose on mountain tops there are health resorts and mountain or hill stations, because people during summer season from plain and plateau reach there as a tourist for recreation or for the betterment of health. But at the same time, contrary to good health, in the Bhabhar region there is filaria and malaria diseases, where in Bhabhar there is collection of boulders, and under those boulder landscape water stagnates, which causes a number of diseases like malaria and filaria. So it is geomorphic process and landform which causes diseases and which is suitable for health. That's why it is also a part of applied geomorphology. Last point is geomorphology and forestry. As we have discussed that forestry is very important topic of environment department, especially in India, in arid and semi-arid region, and in abroad also. In arid and semi-arid region, all the concerned governments are today planning the development of forestry, and it is also targeted that 60% part of the mountain should also be covered with the forest, for which afforestation, reforestation and social forestry are the wings bringing this into practice. So we have seen that for all the branches, for all the fields involved in the development of human society, this knowledge of geomorphology is of most use. Thus we have discussed that in applied geomorphology there are three aspects. Aspect number one is that the six fluvial process and landforms developed by them are being used for the human welfare of the society and environment by the geomorphologist. Second point is on mountain, plateau and plain, geomorphologists are using the knowledge for human welfare. And third aspect is that all the scientific department involved for the betterment of society are taking the geomorphological knowledge into consideration.